On a December morning in 1941, Japanese planes approached the main United States naval base at Pearl Harbor, intent on destroying as much of the Pacific Fleet as possible. At exactly the same time, another force was attacking British positions in the Malay Peninsula. What were the reasons behind these surprise attacks? And what did the Japanese mean when they said that the war had been started so that Japan could assume its proper place in the world?
Most people have never understood why Japan suddenly attacked the United States at Pearl Harbor, leading to untold misery and deaths for both Americans and Japanese. Indeed, this shrine is dedicated to the millions of Japanese who died. What we're attempting to explain, without for 1 minute excusing these actions, is why the Japanese felt they had to go to such desperate lengths. Because without a better understanding of this period of Japanese history, East and West may never be able to understand each other.
War veterans gather in Tokyo to remember their fallen comrades. Comrades who paid with their lives by the millions in the years that followed Pearl Harbor. Here at the Yasukuni Shrine, prayers are offered for the peace of their souls. But the Yasukuni Shrine is more than just a memorial for old soldiers. It's also steeped in political controversy, as the place where 14 top war criminals are included in the many souls enshrined here, including Japan's wartime leader, Prime Minister Tojo. In the summer of 1985, Prime Minister Yasuhiro Nakasone made an official visit to the shrine, a move that caused protests in Japan itself and riots in China. More than 40 years after the end of the war, Japan's continuing search for its proper place in the world is still controversial. For most of Japan's history, the sea has isolated it from the turmoil of the Asian mainland. Too fierce and too poor to be thought worth invading, it had been largely left alone. But 150 years ago, that all began to change. Until then, Japan had been surrounded by independent kingdoms. But the expansion of the colonial powers into Asia rapidly altered the map. China was first bullied into allowing trading posts, and then savaged by the massive importation of opium. The British ruled vast areas to the west. Imperial Russia expanded until it controlled the islands immediately to the north of Japan. The French and Dutch controlled what little was left. And towards the end of the last century, America expanded across the Pacific to take control of Hawaii, Guam, and the Philippines. The Japanese had good reason to feel that they might be next. By the 1920s, the Japanese far right bitterly attacked increasing Western influence, as in this film, complaining of the Western dress and manners of the once demure Japanese female. One form of Western behavior the right wing did approve of was empire building. Japan moved into those few remaining areas close to its shores that had managed to remain independent. First Korea, and then Manchuria, conveniently situated for Japanese expansion. And as the 1930s ran their course, they expanded farther into the Chinese heartland. The Japanese won victory after victory over the divided Chinese, occupying even greater areas of China, but never capable of controlling the whole vast continent. Propaganda films made for domestic Japanese consumption showed the victorious Japanese army being warmly welcomed by the Chinese. And in a China split between feuding warlords, Chiang Kai-shek's nationalists and Mao's communists, the Japanese occupation at least guaranteed the end of fighting and something to eat. The Japanese believed, just like the Americans in the Philippines, that they were bringing peace and civilization to people who desperately needed it. This propaganda film was made to try to persuade the world of the humanity of the conquering Japanese army towards the peasants of China. What Manchuria provided was relief for a depression-hit Japan, overpopulated, needing more farmland, raw materials, and captive markets. This film was made in Manchuria to show to farming communities back in Japan, to encourage them to emigrate in the golden era dawning for the new Japanese empire. Very similar films were made at this time by all the colonial powers, with much the same thrust as this one, emphasizing opportunity, progress, and civilization. And the Japanese people responded to these films by moving into Manchuria in large numbers. By the end of the 30s, there were more Japanese colonialists in Manchuria than there were British in India. And just as the British imported their home comforts to India, so this film ends with a dance done by every Japanese farming community at midsummer, a sign that though far from home, Japanese values still prevailed. But the rest of the world perceived the Japanese colonization in a rather different light.
Thousands of foreigners watch the arrival of Japanese bombing planes. The Chinese flee for their lives as machine guns spray a deadly curtain of lead from above. Terror rides the skies, and in the streets, panic-stricken natives seek the most pitiful of shelters.
Hey,
These bombings came only just after the world had experienced the full horror of the aerial bombing of Guernica and led to widespread feelings of anger and revulsion against the Japanese.
Ghastly, unimaginable sights that bring vividly to mind the horror of unrestricted warfare. A terrible lesson for all the world. Terrible, heart-rending scenes. But just what any city may expect in the future, when nations flame into the fiery fury of hate and war.
The West began pressing for an economic embargo against Japan, in particular an embargo on oil, which the Japanese needed for their now massive army in China. Japan had no source of oil under its own control, and so the embargo was a most effective threat. And the longer it lasted, the shorter were Japan's supplies of oil. As its oil stocks dwindled, Japan was forced to choose between a humiliating withdrawal from her new Chinese empire or a gamble on the quick military successes over America and Britain. Japan gambled, and Japan lost. For the first time in its entire history, Japan was successfully invaded by a foreign power. The man put in charge of the defeated nation was General Douglas MacArthur.
The stage was set. General MacArthur walked from a cabin to open the surrender ceremonies.
We are gathered here, representatives of the major warring powers, to conclude a solemn agreement whereby peace may be restored.
From the beginning, at the ceremonies aboard the battleship Missouri, he stressed the theme of the generous victim.
These proceedings are closed.
Even before he first landed in Japan, MacArthur had given considerable thought to the future of the country. Almost alone among his contemporaries, he was without rancor towards the defeated Japanese. He saw his job not to punish, but to create a new society. At the very start of his administration, he stated his goals.
To secure for the Japanese people freedom of speech, religion, and thought, and respect for the fundamental human rights. To remove all obstacles to the strengthening of democratic tendencies among the Japanese people, and to readjust the Japanese industrial economy to produce the Japanese people after reparations an equitable standard of life.
He initiated a series of radical reforms reaching every part of Japanese life. Many administrating these changes were Roosevelt's New Dealers. And the changes they created were the most radical reforms ever carried out by a military occupation. And if ever there was a nation needing the energy and drive of MacArthur's men, it was post-war Japan. The country was devastated. There was little housing or food. The only part of the economy that worked was the black market. Into this confusion, chaos, and misery came the clear, incisive style of MacArthur and his mission to reform. Land was to be distributed to the peasants. Exploitation by absentee landlords was to end. And for this alone, MacArthur would be remembered. But land reform was only a start. The giant industrial cartels, the Zaibatsu, were broken up. Women were given the vote, the nobility abolished, the rich heavily taxed, and most controversial of all, labor unions strongly encouraged. Under MacArthur, union membership soared from 400,000 before the war to 4.5 million by the end of his first year in Japan. This post-war American idealism did not come without its problems, as Japan had almost no history of moderate trade unionism, and most of the top labor leaders of the era were communists. Slowly, very, very slowly, the Japanese economy began to recover. The far-sightedness of MacArthur's reforms were matched in clarity and efficiency by the Japanese economic planners. Scarce resources were concentrated at first on heavy industry and on the traditionally strong area of textile manufacturing. New areas were also allowed to develop with the first serious Japanese car industries and the high-tech area of television manufacturing. But this wasn't haphazard economic growth. It was carefully planned and controlled by the government civil servants. The first stage was called Ju-Ko-Cho-Dai. Heavy, thick, long, big. Free from the substantial financial burden of a large defense force, the Japanese were able to concentrate on iron and steel production. With such success that in 1957, a mere 11 years after its devastation, Japan had the most modern steel mills in the world. Within a decade, Japan had created the base for the strongest and most modern economy in the post-war world. This achieved, it was ready for the next stage. Miniaturization has always been a particular Japanese skill. In an overcrowded island, the love of the small and beautiful is not surprising. And in the post-war years, the Japanese were to use these skills in new and startling ways. The world's first transistor radio. The first of a vast number of innovative products in the new stage of economic growth. Kei Haku Tan Sho. Light, thin, short, small. This new stage brought with it new jobs and better working conditions. But modern though these offices are, much of the work is done within Japanese traditions. This young designer is working at plans for a new audio speaker for a television. This design will be accepted only after it's passed a series of rigorous tests. Most important of which is a session where the designer has to justify his ideas to a group representing many areas of the company. As ever in Japan, it's the group that decides the fate of his new design.
Yeah. レビじゃないけど、やっぱりその、あまり余分な飾りのないとかね、
そういう感じだと思うんですが、民間中への入国が要請というのは、作れるの
は、This is where the decisions to move from heavy industry into electronics was planned and coordinated. The headquarters of MITI, the Ministry of International Trade and Industry. Here, the elite of the Japanese civil service cajole industrialists into doing things MITI's way. Here, the next stage of Japanese economic growth is being planned with the slogan, Bi Kang Yu So, beauty, feeling, play, creativity, meaning an emphasis on software, media, travel, and fashion, all pursuits of a middle-class country with money to spend. And today's Japanese consumer has a vast range of things to spend it on. This is truly a land where the customer is king. One of the favorite ways of eating in Tokyo is Japan's answer to fast food, the roller sushi bar. Each one of these dishes is a different color, denoting a different price. But even though some of these dishes cost less than a dollar, quality, freshness, and attention to detail shows in every plate. Not only that, but it all looks so beautiful. At all levels of Japanese life, quality of service and attention to detail is the norm. And just look what happens when you go to fill your car with gasoline. Japanese economic success is based on the ability to fuse the best of the West with the powerful traditions underlying Japanese life. Concepts of loyalty, group conformity, and above all else, a sense of what is necessary for national survival. Post-war years taught the Japanese that it's only by continuing economic growth that they can maintain their proper place in the world. But not everyone has shared equally in Japan's economic miracle. In rural areas, many women still do grinding, back-breaking work in conditions that are no better than the third world. These workers are cleaning oyster shells for the large cultivated pearl industry. The middle-class urban male has been the chief beneficiary of Japan's new wealth. Women, on the whole, have had a much tougher time of it. Even if you are employed in a white-collar job, your career prospects are limited. In a firm as progressive as Sony, these women stand little chance of making it to the very top of the company. You'll find only girls in home economic classes. And even if they get a good college education, society still expects them to leave work when they marry and be full-time housewives and mothers. On the other hand, these boys in the traditional shop class will have a much easier time getting into a top college and into a top job. Society still teaches them that the Japan they will inherit will be a man's world. And these stone dolls mark a grimmer reality for Japanese women.
Many visitors to Japan see these colorful little dolls, their pinwheels blowing in the wind, without ever realizing what human sadness lies behind them. People who leave these dolls also write messages. This one says, "I'm sorry I can't give you life in this world. I shall never forget you. You were born to live, but due to our selfishness, we decided to kill you. Forgive me. I shall never make the same mistake again. Please be happy and well when you are born again. I'm sorry. I'm truly sorry. Please rest peacefully under the many colorful windmills from your mother. This temple was built to honor children who died very young or were aborted. In this male-dominated society, it's been very difficult for women to get the family planning and birth control advice that's available in the West. Kikue Maeda is a Tokyo housewife who works part-time typing out driver's licenses. The Japanese economy couldn't function without workers like Kikue. Paid substantially less than men, women in Japan have served the same function that immigrant labor has performed in the West. She lives with her husband and two children in a typical rabbit hutch tower block in central Tokyo. By Western standards, her living space is small, with the bedroom doubling as a sitting and dining room. But the space is organized with care, and by sleeping on futons on the floor that are cleared away in the morning, maximum use is made out of the space. A rabbit hutch it may be, but it's a rabbit hutch with amenities. Kikue loves tennis and spends many a fine afternoon on the nearby tennis court.
Her husband, a keen golfer, has an equally short walk to the golfing range. And the same sports complex provides swimming lessons for their children. In common with all Japanese families, Kikue would love more living space. But putting up with these conditions does mean that more of the family income can be spent outside the home. It's Kikue who makes the family budgetary decisions. In common with almost all Japanese males, Kikue's husband hands over his paycheck to his wife, accepts an allowance that she thinks reasonable, and allows his wife to make all the family financial decisions, giving women an economic power in Japan that belies their Madam Butterfly image in the West. And it's an economic power that Japanese industry is well aware of. This is an office in Japan's largest advertising agency. And these women have been paid to give their opinions on a wide range of consumer products. As women choose both their husband's suits and the family vacation, advertisers are keen to know their views. Slowly but surely, the number of Japanese women holding senior posts is increasing. And though their numbers in the Diet, the Japanese parliament, are still lower than in the West, one woman politician has recently made a major breakthrough. Chairwoman Doi has become the first woman leader of a major Japanese political party, the Japanese Socialist Party, the main opposition to the Liberal Democratic Party, which has ruled Japan since the war. Her forceful style and her flair for publicity has considerably enhanced her party's standing in the polls. And if Japan has a change of government in this century, this woman could be prime minister. What would be her priorities if elected?
As far as the cities are concerned, Japan is not spending enough. We need to put more emphasis on completing the sewers and water systems in cities, improving our urban parks, and providing more playgrounds for children. We should spend far more on roads and so greatly improve our urban lifestyle. In these areas, we are very behind. We must change our attitudes to spending in these areas. And in fact, this will affect the problem of our trade imbalance. When our people's basic needs are satisfied, they will have greater purchasing power to buy goods from abroad.
What is Japan going to do with its newfound wealth? What does the new stage of beauty, feeling, play, and creativity mean for the rest of the world? Japan's previous economic stages of steel and electronics have had devastating effects on the world. Now they're moving into beauty, creativity, and leisure. It's doubtful if Japan will export this leisure industry to the West. The enormously popular pinball game of pachinko. But in one leisure industry, Japan is already making waves. No one's better dressed or more fashion conscious than the young Japanese. Sato Sumori is one of the new breed of designers that is rapidly transforming Tokyo into a major center of world fashion. The same energy and drive that the Japanese once put into steel and electronics are now going into clothes design. Chisato designs exclusively for the 16 to 24 age group. And so lucrative is this particular market that for this one show, she flew in top models from all over the world. Japanese women in the 16 to 24 age group are usually in well-paid jobs, but being unmarried, live with their parents. This means they have a substantial income to spend. And spend it they do, on clothes and makeup. A different side of the New Japan is being lived out here on rain-swept Sado Island, where members of the Kodo Drummers group live, starting every morning with a 10-mile run. They live in a drafty old schoolhouse. Young men and women come from all over Japan to learn how to play the traditional Japanese festival drums. tutored by one of the most senior of Kodo's drummers, new members are put through rigorous training sessions to see if they will qualify for the senior drumming group. If accepted, they will travel widely, representing the new face of Japanese culture to the world. The life of a Kodo drummer or Tokyo fashion designer is only for a tiny minority. The rest of the population is faced with surviving in the overcrowded conditions of late 20th century Japan. This is a landscape that has all but vanished, replaced by this, the urban sprawl that is now home to most Japanese. As the century comes to an end, Japan faces new and difficult problems. What to do with the new wealth? How to improve an environment that has been totally sacrificed to economic growth? And most crucial of all, how to sustain that economic growth into the future. Day at Kawasaki's Kobe shipyard. Always a proud moment for one of Japan's oldest and largest yards. But this launch was different. Once this ship had slipped down the ramp, no more would ever be built. Competition from South Korea was bringing shipbuilding here to an end. As is traditional for large firms like Kawasaki, the workers were retrained to do other jobs with the company's many plants. This man once painted ships. He now programs computers in the company's motorcycle operation. Once, Kawasaki would have retrained all its shipyard workers. Now it retrains only the younger and brighter ones. The rest were fired. And in the smaller firms, there's no retraining program and no unions to fight plant closures. The high yen is putting considerable strains on operations like this one. Operations that the rest of Asia can do for a fraction of the Japanese costs. And some economists have argued that if Japan calculated its unemployment figures in the same way as the United States, her rate would be closer to 7% unemployed rather than the official 3%, which is why middle-aged women can still be seen doing heavy manual labor on construction sites. In a country with very limited welfare benefits, you hang on to whatever you've got. Even the cream of the Japanese workforce is worried. On the shop floor of Honda and Toyota, the talk is of the new car plants their companies are building overseas and how this will affect their future careers. But these anxieties don't receive much sympathy in the West. Here, the questions are more likely to be, why can you sell us so many of your cars while we sell you so few of ours? Why do Japanese consumers flock to buy cars and bikes made by their domestic industries and so rarely buy the products of Detroit? Once the answer would have been simple. Detroit couldn't export its cars or bikes to Japan because the Japanese bureaucracy made it impossibly difficult. This, however, is no longer true for cars and for many other items where tariff restrictions have been lifted. The reason why it's so hard to sell to the Japanese is because of the peculiar way Japan structures its domestic market. Japan distributes its goods in one of the most complex and labor-intensive ways in the world. What is true of fish is also true of all other goods, be they imported Cadillacs or locally caught shrimp. Far more people are involved in getting the product to the consumer than in any other developed economy. Fish unloaded in Nagasaki are transported to the Tokyo Fish Market, one of the modern wonders of the world. Through these halls pass a fifth of the world's fish harvest. At 5 a.m., the place is packed with people, examining the quality of the fresh and frozen tuna. Then a series of auctions of Byzantine complexity ensure that in half an hour, most of the tuna will have passed through four different companies before it finally leaves the market. In this way, vast numbers of people are involved in distribution. It's been calculated to be more than four times the number of people than would be involved in the West. It's a system that provides employment. It's also a system that makes it very difficult for any foreign company to sell its products in Japan. For what is true of fish, is also true of everything one might want to sell the Japanese. To sell in Japan, you have to use the Japanese distribution network. This can be done, but it takes time, investment, an understanding of the culture, and an ability to speak Japanese. Sadly, in the past, far too few Western companies have thought it worth their while to go to that much trouble. And yet, the Japanese market is huge. Over 100 million well-paid consumers, hungry for new and stylish products from the West. Complex though the distribution system may be, it can be used by foreign companies if they have the energy and drive to do so. For the Japanese, this system provides an unrivaled quality of choice. Anything from a simple shrimp to something more exotic. This is a fugu, the famous poison puffer fish. Parts of its body contain a peculiarly powerful poison, and one mistake in its preparation, and a particularly horrible death awaits the diner. This dish costs a small fortune. At the other end of the scale, in roller sushi bars all over Japan, the high quality of their distribution system ensures the diners a cheap, safe, and delicious meal. The Japanese consumer is used to high standards and high quality. Until goods from the West can match these expectations, the problems of huge trade surpluses will remain. One way in which this can begin to happen is by the West taking a greater interest in what it is that makes the Japanese tick. In the past, the American image of Japan focused on the quaint and comical. We in the West were also comfortable with the doll-like and the traditional. What we've yet to even begin coming to terms with is the economic dynamism of a country whose stock exchange is now worth as much as Wall Street. Japan's success is based on the skillful blend of the best of its past with the cutting edge of modern technology. The children of today's Japan are being well trained to inherit that success and continue it into the 21st century. By the time these children and our children graduate from college, they'll be making the decisions that will shape the world. It's important that these children and our children are better communicators than our parents were, or indeed for that matter than we are today. If we're to avoid the mistakes of the past, it's crucial that the people of the two most powerful economies of the free world, Japan and the United States, learn to understand each other, and thus ensure a brighter future for all our children.
We hope you've enjoyed the Channel 11 production of the series Japan. Be with us next week at this time when Paul Duke hosts the premiere program in a two-part series on the workings of the U.S. Supreme Court, this honorable court. And stay with 11 now as we begin a 14-part series on life in the Soviet Union, Comrades.